Good afternoon. Hello, and welcome to our BSA webinar, The Criticality of Choice in the Next Normal. I'm Diana Nicholas, President and CEO of SOM Architecture, and a member of the BSA Board of Directors. Thank you all for joining to discuss choice in the new or next normal of work and workplace. Before we begin, some housekeeping and general updates. The BSA Connect LinkedIn Forum is a forum on LinkedIn that we welcome you all to join. It's meant to be a place where you can pose questions, share and find community outside of knowledge community meetings and other BSA programming. You can find it by searching for BSA Connect on LinkedIn. This webinar will be a part of a series of BSA online programs exploring what the future of work and workspace will look like post-COVID. Please visit architects.org for information on upcoming programs, knowledge community meetings, as well as upcoming online training sessions. If you are interested in sponsoring, please contact Billy Craig at bcraig@architects.org. So today for our Q&A period, we've selected a number of questions that were submitted ahead of time. Thank you for sharing these. Though we will not be able to address all the questions, we encourage you to share any you might have during the webinar by using the Q&A function. If the speakers are able to, they will respond. Otherwise, the BSA may use these questions to inform future programming. This session will be recorded and posted on architects.org in the next few days. This presentation is going to engage participants with real-time polling via Meeting Sift. Please use another device, such as a phone or a tablet. The URL and password are going to be included in the presentation slides. Responses are anonymous, and we share the results during the meeting. Now, I'm excited to introduce you to our presenters, Colleen Aria, Principal at Stantec, and Amy Hill, Principal at Workflow. Colleen Aria is a Principal and Interior Designer with Stantec. She co-leads the Workplace Design practice in the Boston office and brings 18 years of experience across workplace, commercial mixed use, institutional, multifamily, and student housing design. She believes and strives to make design an inclusive and holistic process, enabling clients to discover how their goals and workplace culture can be supported and transformed through collaborative placemaking. And Amy Hill is a principal and workplace strategist at Workflow and comes to the table with 20 years of corporate interior design, workplace strategy, change management, and furniture industry experience. Her mission is to help clients make their workplaces work better, both spatially and behaviorally. Her experiences working with a wide range of clients have sparked her interest in understanding and enabling the levers of high performance within companies and teams. With that, I will turn it over to Amy.
Great. Thank you so much, Diana, for that warm welcome, and welcome everybody here today, and thank you for taking the time to join us. Also, a big thanks to the BSA for hosting us and giving us a platform for which to share our ideas. So first today, we want to start by acknowledging the great body of work that's being shared widely by many organizations in our industry. We encourage you to leverage that body of knowledge for the more tactical aspects of reentry. There's a lot of great information out there. But our goal today is to take a step back and share our thoughts on the role of choice and talk about the psychology around reentry and co-creating the next workplace normal. And we can't co-create without you. So this session is going to be interactive. As Diana said, we're going to be using that tool called Meeting Sift. So this tool will also make this session a learning experience for all of us, so we can learn in real time our collective thoughts and perceptions, which we can take with us after the meeting today into our own workplaces and client workplaces after the session. So just so you are aware, if you notice me looking down a lot during the presentation, I'm driving the whole thing from my phone. So I'm not surfing Instagram or anything like that. So bear with us as we move through this. So please get your phones out. You're always going to see the code up at the top right-hand side of the part of the screen. So join in your browser at sift.ly and enter the code FDYN. And you'll be in, and the questions will present themselves to you as we go through. So with that, Colleen's going to start you off with some basic demographic questions so that we can learn a little bit more about you.
Great. Thanks, Amy. So we know that a bunch of you that registered online were mainly designers and vendor reps, but we want to just take a pulse right now on who is joining the crowd. We've got, look at all this inputting information. This is great.
Kind of like a wheel of fortune as it spins around.
I know. I love that.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. So it looks like we've got some more project managers as well, some end users. That's great. Yes. All right. So hopefully that wasn't too difficult. Let's go on to some more questions. All right. We'd also like to understand the role that you play within your organization. So again, just look at your phone. You should have the next prompt. We want to know if you're a leader, a manager, or an individual contributor. Fantastic. Oh, look at this.
Yeah.
A lot of managers.
Yes.
And contributors. That's great. So we're going to talk about a lot of different theories that can be applied not only within the workplace, but hopefully when you manage other things in your life. Like I'm managing a lot of kids right now. All right, so hopefully you've all found it pretty simple and to use this software. So let's go on to the next question. So we know that upon registering, many of you responded whether or not your view of remote work has changed. And we got some great feedback, which we'll touch upon. But now we'd like to understand if that change is for the better, for worse, not sure. So let us know with your phones how the pandemic has changed your view on remote work.
This is interesting.
Favorably, look at that.
Yeah.
It's like a battle.
I know. The war of the percentages.
Right?
Yeah. So, wow. So it looks like 70%. Their view has changed favorably, or almost 30%, no change, I was a fan before, but 70% total between favorable and I was already a fan.
Oh, this is great. Thank you, everyone. So
fantastic.
Now that we know a little bit more about you all and your views on remote work, which again, we'll talk about a little bit later, we're going to get into what Amy and I believe will be the key ingredients of successful workplaces and leadership in the next normal. So take it away, Amy.
All right. So this is our hypothesis. We propose that there's an opportunity that this pandemic has presented to all of us, and we see it as a catalyst to create a new workplace paradigm. Our hypothesis is that organizations that mobilize towards choice and prioritize stakeholder-based decision-making will be the most sought after and successful in the next normal. In this brave new world, organizations that operate under the external control mindset, aka carrot and stick, will be left behind. We're not suggesting that this will happen overnight. So, since we're talking about choice today, and we think about mobilizing towards choice, we have another exercise for you. Now, before you enter anything, this is a word cloud exercise. So one word answers are ideal for this format, but you can enter up to three different words to speak to what workplace choice means to you. So please go ahead, pick up your phones, and enter your answers. Mm. No.
Freedom.
Yes. That's freedom. A good word. Of which we have none right now.
Oh God, we're going to talk about that too. Well, look at that. Freedom is the biggest word so far, with flexibility. Definitely a pattern.
Home, remote. Personal,
any place. I like that one.
Trust. It's great.
Oh yeah, that's a good one.
Versatile. That's a good one. Oh wow, look at this jumping around.
This is fun.
independence, interaction, healthy, did I see healthy? Walking, good.
Mm.
Yeah.
Flex. Peter Elliott saying flex.
Yes. Short for flexibility.
Yeah. Or maybe he's flexing more. I'm not certain.
Maybe, oh, yeah. Maybe he's working out more.
I am, for sure. Right.
Yeah. But okay, so clearly the words that are the largest and at the center are the ones that are people are saying over and over again, by the way. So the smaller the word, the fewer people are saying it. That doesn't make it less important, but you see that there is definitely an overriding theme here for sure. So we're going to be jotting down some notes for some callbacks later on in the conversation. Autonomy. Oh, I love that word.
And freedom.
Freedom, flexibility, autonomy. Ooh, modularity. Ooh. Modular work home office, perhaps. All right. Are we ready to, I feel like we have a good, we've got, oh, keep getting more in.
I know. I don't want to go on, but we have to.
Cut anybody off, but we have to.
We could okay. do this for 2 hours.
We could. We really could. Okay. But this is really great. Thank you all for participating. Okay. So this is a quick Cliff Notes version of a psychology theory called choice theory. It can be applied in all aspects of our lives, but today we're focusing on the workplace. Choice theory, developed by Dr. William Glasser, is based on the simple premise that every individual only has the power to control themselves and has limited power to control others. In the workplace, this means individuals are empowered to take responsibility for their own actions and choices and support others in taking ownership of their choices. As a result, negative behaviors reduce in frequency and intensity. Relationships strengthen and satisfaction in life increases. So, since we all spend at least a third of our lives at work, it seems that workplace satisfaction would improve life satisfaction in general. As it applies to the workplace, leader management, and you may also have seen this referred to as servant leadership, creates a cooperative system based on trust and empathy. It requires getting to know each employee and understanding what makes them tick. On the face of it, it may sound a little warm and fuzzy, but it actually leads to higher quality work and lower cost to an organization. A simple equation, low cost, high benefit. So in Glasser's book, Choice Theory, these leader managers do 4 things differently than another leadership style that we're going to discuss shortly. These 4 things are that they continuously engage all workers, and they continuously listen and ask those workers for their suggestions on the best way to get the work done. These leaders model the work for employees, and they encourage employee input. And employees are also empowered to review their own work, as well as they support quality by facilitating an environment of continual improvement and also a positive and safe workplace. So the North Star for every decision that these leaders make is this question: if I do this, will I get closer to the people I work with or further away? If the answer is the latter, they don't do it, or they find another way. Our hope is that everybody on this call has or will have the benefit of being mentored by this kind of a leader. On the other end of the continuum from choice theory is external control. The basic beliefs of an external control mindset are that I can make other people do what I want them to do, even if they don't want to do it. Other people can control how I think, act, and feel. And lastly, that it is right to punish those who don't do what I tell them to do, or maybe reward them if it'll get them to do what I want them to do. Again, that old carrot and stick approach that is still pervasive in today's workplaces. From an organizational leadership standpoint, this is referred to as boss management. We've all worked for bosses before. These bosses likely manage with fear, coercion, and distrust of the people with whom they work, creating an adversarial and fear-based work environment. In stark contrast to the management style we were just talking about, these leaders set the standards themselves and rarely consult the employees on what those standards should be. They tell rather than show and rarely ask for input on how it could be done better. The boss inspects the work. The employees are not involved with that evaluation. And when employees resist the boss uses threats and punishments to try to make them do what he or she wants. Doesn't sound quite as inspiring as the previous model, does it?
It's horrible. I don't want to work for that boss.
No, nobody does. Nobody does. So this management style could speak to an entire organizational culture, especially if it starts at the top. However, it is possible to have both leader managers and boss managers within the same organization.
Oh, thanks, Amy, for giving us that 5-minute crash course in choice theory. I think I should probably be implementing some of those ideas as I manage my children these days.
That's a whole other webinar.
I know, it really is, quite honestly. Yeah. Amy and I think it's important to point out that the application of choice theory applies not only to leadership and management philosophy, but it also extends into the broader employee experience, including workplace policy, company culture, strategy, design, and placemaking, and hopefully into the greater social fabric. This is because ultimately it's the leaders that are making the final decisions on all of these aspects of our workplace experience. We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but now let's look at a few indicators that we believe are good gauges of evolving sentiments and influences on workplace policy and placemaking. There are many markers that we could review, but we only have an hour today and felt that these particular ones were most relevant. The affordability crisis. This is a term coined by Annie Lowry at The Atlantic, and it refers to an aggregate of increasing workforce economic costs, such as housing, healthcare, and childcare, which all directly impact worker performance and well-being. Remote work. We're defining as working from home or outside the office, but not necessarily traveling for work. So this also would include co-working. Open office perceptions. This is pretty self-explanatory, and we're all probably very aware of the backlash against open offices leading up to and even now in the pandemic. I mean, there's lots of, you know, proclamations about the open office is finally dead. So we'll talk about that too. And last, but probably most important, especially given the current state, we want to look at how workplace policy and environments have thus far and will continue to support physical and mental health of employees. So, you're all going to continue to be our test subjects, and we're going to take the temperature on a few of these indicators with you all. So take out your phones again, and if you're just joining us, you can take part in the polling by using the logon information you see at the top of the presentation screen. So we're curious to understand more about how these indicators may or may not be impacting you, as well as establishing some benchmarking data. So before the pandemic, what was your average round trip commute time? Let's see. So working in Boston, as we imagine many of you do, or around the Boston area, we're all well aware of the affordable housing crisis. Over the last 5 years, housing prices have grown faster than incomes in not only urban and suburban markets, but now in rural areas as well. And this is pushing the workforce away from jobs, essentially. So that has led the U.S. to have an average round trip commute time of 50 minutes. So let's see where our poll stands.
Most 60 are, yeah.
80 minutes?
Wow. Yeah, 37% are at 60 to 80 minutes.
That's a lot of time.
Mm-hmm. It is.
We have another webinar to talk about that.
Yes.
What everybody's doing now with all that time.
Share podcasts and everything. Yeah.
But I mean, in all seriousness, this is a huge issue, not only because of affordability, but also as it relates to mental health. There's research that shows that for every extra minute of commuting time, it reduces both job and leisure time satisfaction, but it also increases strain and worsens mental health for workers. So, you know, commuting, it's a problem. So again, this starts to reveal how greater socioeconomic issues can decrease choice in workers' lives and lead to negative outcomes for workers as well as employers. All right, let's get to the next one. We want to know, in the time before the pandemic, how often you all worked from home. I love how this is all moving.
I know.
Fun. Hopefully it's keeping you all awake and interested.
Yes.
It's so hard, all these Zoom calls, right? Like, they just bleed together. So this is fun. All right. So we're seeing an average of 1 to 2 days per month.
Wow, the majority, 1 to 2 days per month or never.
Wow.
So going from that to 5 days a week for many of us.
Oh my God, talk about a shock to the system.
Oh, wait, we just flipped 1 to 2 days a week, just beat out never. But still.
No, per month. Oh, and then one, okay, so that's-
The next one, yep. Yeah, great.
All right.
Okay, let's move on.
So now that we're in the world's largest work from home experiment, Amy and I are curious to understand how effectively you feel you are working from home. You know, and with the understanding that trying to get your work done during a pandemic looks a bit different than a usual workday from home. So, you know, try to think about maybe if you didn't have to teach your kids or care for another individual while you're trying to get your work done, how effective you would be.
Well, we've got 84% so far either agree or strongly agree.
That's incredible. We need more work from home.
Now it's changing a little bit, but still the majority. Yes, the vast majority. No strongly disagrees.
No, and we've got some neutrals, which isn't a bad thing.
13%.
Okay. We have one last question before we start talking some more. All right. We're very curious to understand how many days a week working from home post-pandemic, once we come out of this, would support you being effective in your role. And so while this is all coming in, I'm just going to keep rolling. You know, nationally, remote work has been growing over the last 15 years by about 173%. And this was leading up to the pandemic. And only about 43% of employees nationally were working, you know, with some degree remotely prior to the pandemic. However, 80% of U.S. employees wanted some level of remote work. So there was already this gap in choice and availability of remote work before the pandemic. Let's see. That's great.
Definitely. There's a shift to more people wanting to work from home more, because before it was 1 to 2 days a month at the top, and then 1 to 2 days a week, and then never. So we've seen 1 to 2 days a week and 3 to 4 days a week become much more prominent as far as desire. And we still have some nevers, and that's okay, because it doesn't have to work for everybody.
Exactly. Well, thank you, everyone.
Thank you. This is great.
Feedback come in. So let's get back to those indicators that we were talking about. We've just seen that prior to the pandemic, there were mixed levels of choice regarding when, where, and how we're all working. Remote work was often regarded as a perk, and commute times were increasing to the detriment of our health. And when we look at these indicators in the time of the pandemic, the concept of choice is almost non-existent, right? So many people are forced to work remotely, and essential and low-wage workers are risking their safety as they are required to work. Again, so no choice. Employees are losing their jobs at record numbers and pays. Childcare is non-existent. And non-critical healthcare is in many cases in a frozen state. So again, we're in this time period where our choices have been taken away. So let's look at open office. Prior to the pandemic, we were questioning the ability to work effectively in open environments and considering returning to enclosed offices despite the demand to reduce real estate and increase density. So there was this conundrum of open office doesn't work, but yet we have to increase density. And so we're kind of in this weird predicament. So while there was some choice prior to the pandemic, now that we're living in this era, we're fearful of going back to the office, never mind sharing an open environment with other colleagues, and personal footprints are potentially expanding in consideration of personal safety. So again, we're seeing limited to no choice for workplace design because it's being dictated by fear and needing to meet basic safety measures. And last, physical and mental health. While in pre-pandemic times, there were growing strides to foster healthier environments via sustainable building certifications like LEED, right? And amenity program like fitness centers and healthy food options. But the support of wellness as it relates to mental health in policy and placemaking was lagging. So prior to the pandemic, the CDC confirms that 1 in 5 Americans will experience a mental illness in a given year. And driving the mental health crisis is the loneliness epidemic. Cigna's annual loneliness research report indicates that 61% of Americans state that they are lonely and are less engaged, less productive, and report lower retention rates. So adding to that, remote workers are more likely than non-remote workers to always or sometimes feel alone. So this is terribly concerning when we're all now working remotely in this pandemic era, not all of us, but a good portion. And we don't have a choice to do otherwise. So let's just step back a minute to think about how the pandemic has forced our society into a place of limited to no choice, a place driven mainly by external control, as Amy described. This pyramid, as some of you may know, and here's our second psychology lesson of the forum.
Sorry.
This pyramid illustrates a psychology theory, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. In this theory, the basic human requirements are broken into 5 levels that build upon each other. Psychological needs, physiological needs, safety needs, love and belonging, esteem, and at the top is self-actualization. You have to do that when you talk about self-actualization.
It's just well played.
In order to achieve any given level, the needs below that particular level must be met. So self-actualization made easy in 5 simple steps, right? No problem.
Right.
So now in the pandemic life that we're all experiencing, our needs have been reduced to the bottom 2 tiers, which Maslow categorizes as basic needs, like air, water, food, shelter, personal security, employment, health. Not a great place to be in for a long period of time, right? Right. So when we start to look at the next 2 tiers, our psychological needs, that include friendship, sense of connection, respect, self-esteem, recognition. These are needs that many of us fulfill when we're at work. Or at the very least, our workplaces should foster an environment and a culture that supports these needs, especially since, as Amy mentioned earlier, we spend a third of our lives working. So let's get to some more personal questions.
Yes, but before we do that, I just want to do a little callback to how you all think about choice in that word cloud, the first word cloud that we did. We talked about flexibility, freedom, and autonomy. And so if we start to look at that up, that starts to get up towards the esteem, the psychological need for esteem. So just kind of bringing that to mind as you think about how these things apply to that hierarchy of needs. Okay. So, are we ready for the warm and fuzzy part now? Okay. This is another word cloud exercise where we would like you to submit a word that best describes what you miss most about going to the office. You may enter up to 3 different words.
People, 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 people.
It's like you're a mind reader, Colleen.
Oh, ta-da.
Yeah.
Colleagues.
Interaction. Social, coffee, does he see coffee in there? Coffee, energy,
Whoever can't get coffee, let me know.
Yeah, we'll send you some coffee.
That's an essential. That is totally
crazy. Can't help you with a barista. We can help you with coffee. Look at the coffee's growing interaction. Maybe it's because we're saying it so much, we should probably stop. Scenery.
So there's a definite theme here.
Somebody said nothing. I just saw nothing flying around somewhere. Nothing.
Hey, you know what? If this is your jam, there's nothing wrong with that either.
No judgment. Desk. Interaction.
Energy.
Adults. Was that yours, Colleen?
I'm potty training a two-year-old right now, so.
That's mine.
Oh, good one, Diana. Thank you. Oh, this is great. Oh, Sydney. Yeah.
Yeah. Great. I feel you there.
Gossip. Wow. Pants.
That's fantastic.
It's great. Oh, you guys are funny. Okay. This is wonderful. Thank you. So we see an overriding theme here, I think, Colleen, is that we really miss people. A lot of the things that we want are things that require being around and seeing people.
Yeah.
So.
We're just starving to get out of those bottom two tiers, right?
Yes. I think so. Okay. This is wonderful. So one more. Since you guys are so good at word clouds, we're going to ask you to do one more. In a word, what are you enjoying about working from home?
Family.
So Jeff Weiner from LinkedIn posted something a while back, probably a few weeks ago, about how much this has taught him, another servant leader as well, how spending this time with his family, like they don't necessarily always have dinner together as a family, and how much that has changed his view about what his next normal is going to be. And that's going to be something that he's not going to negotiate moving forward.
Right.
Flexibility, commute, yeah. Walks, focus, comfort. Kids. So wine. Oh yeah. Makeup. Probably I'm guessing not wearing it. It's if I had to guess.
I think I could go either way. Sometimes makeup makes you feel human again.
That's true. Yeah. Athleisure. Good one. Pajamas. That's great. But okay, so the overriding themes, right? Time, flexibility, family, walks, commute. I'm suspecting that either the commute to the living room is good, or it's the lack of the commute to the office that we're talking about, if I may put words in your all's mouth. Wine is coming in pretty strongly. That's interesting. And freedom. So again, think back to the hierarchy of needs. And you know, as we start to think about co-creating this new normal, seems like there's a pattern emerging, huh, Colleen?
Right. I mean, the interesting point being that remote work and going to the office, the two things that we love the most are the people, right?
Yeah. And it's hard to get these next two tiers, the psychological needs of esteem and love and belonging, without somehow getting to the office, whether that's virtually, physically, or some combination of the two.
Yeah.
So just a quick reminder that our collective goal and our lifelong journey is to get to the top of this pyramid. And right now we are faced with getting beyond our basic needs, and we all have the opportunity to reassess how we fulfill our psychological needs moving forward.
Yeah, I mean, I believe that the workplace and culture, when embracing choice theory, can make positive strides in enabling workers to be the best that they can be, both professionally and personally. So how can we collectively begin changing the workplace paradigm as we co-create our next normal?
So we've been thinking about this next normal on three levels: organization, team, and individual. But instead of the familiar top-down hierarchical approach, we're going to borrow from Gordon McKenzie's book, Orbiting the Giant Hairball, and shift our definition of top-down. If you haven't read this book, We highly, highly recommend it. So you are looking at a plum tree. In this model, the trunk represents top management and is the enduring central support. The branches are the managers and the supervisors, and they exist to support the product producers. And the product producers, aka the cash crop, are at the top. This would likely never ever be the model in an external control environment, but in a choice-based environment, you bet. So there are many possibilities here, like Colleen said, beyond what we've listed, and we encourage you all to brainstorm about what those could be. We're focusing in on these few because we have limited time. So remember that plum tree as we share these possibilities for our next workplace normal. So while we're not directly solving for the affordability crisis, we can help relieve the mental stress of long commutes. In this next normal, top management not only permits or tolerates working from home or other remote work, like co-working, but actively supports it and trusts their people to make the best decisions for them and their teams. The organization or the tree trunk's role is to ensure that the branches and producers have the tools that they need to work most effectively, wherever that may be. By actively supporting working from home or other remote work options and thinking about that remote office space as a space type in our activity-based working worlds, organizations address all four of these indicators.
And Amy, I think it's important to note, just as our hypothesis had said, there's a national poll that backs up our theory that remote work, it's the way to think about providing choice. So there's a national poll on remote work where 35% of employees surveyed would change jobs for the opportunity to work remotely full time. And 37% would do so. So they would change their job if they could work remotely some of the time. So the numbers, are pretty clear and they speak loudly on this. And we even saw it, today that there's a preference to do so.
And this was before the great experiment, right?
Yeah. Great experiment.
Yeah. Maybe that'll be the new term. Mm-hmm. So other things that may happen in this choice-based next normal is that, leadership will be leading the way by modeling these new norms and sharing best practices widely, reinforcing the desired behaviors by offering recognition. And think back to the esteem level of Maslow's pyramid. Recognition is one of those things. It's not a bribe. It's a recognition in front of your peers. And also, the organization would need to offer training and development for managers to develop new skills to manage remote and hybrid teams. Hybrid teams meaning some people may be choosing to work from home while others are at the office and vice versa, hence a hybrid team. Many of us have learned from our past bosses, so it will take time to grow leaders. So if you think back to the plum tree, think about those concentric rings as a tree grows stronger and stronger. Takes time. So, how leaders and organizations choose to respond could improve our work lives and hence our lives in general for the long term. While Colleen and I were preparing for our discussion today, we found an interesting article from the New York Times that we're borrowing from called "Could the Pandemic Wind Up Fixing What's Broken About Work in America?" We found that there is historical precedent for pandemics creating the next normal. In the 1300s, the bubonic plague or Black Death killed an estimated 30 to 60% of the European population. This resulted in a scarcity of labor, which gave peasants more power over their landlords, and this ultimately led to the end of serfdom. More recently, in the United States, prior to World War I, there was a growing labor movement. After World War I, stronger unions and widespread strikes led to the end of the 12-hour workday. So we have them to thank for that, although maybe some of us are still doing that these days because we choose to.
That's right.
The war, in addition to the Spanish flu pandemic of 1918, which interestingly, I just learned those two things overlapped, can you imagine, resulted in a shortage of working men. So many of these jobs became available to women for the first time. As a result, women gained more power to advocate for higher wages and the right to vote. So today, short-term implications are definitely still uncertain as we see what happens as states reopen. We are still collectively dealing with so many unknowns. When is the vaccine coming? Antibody tests, is this thing coming back in the fall? If that's the case, why are we even going back to the office? So this period of time is unique and will be focused around the psychological safety of employees. Some of us are eager to return to the physical workplace, but many are worried about health and safety for themselves and loved ones. Organizational empathy will be critical in this phase. The worst thing an organization can do is force people to come back. Think back to Maslow's pyramid and where that approach would continue to keep employees. There's no way to get the best out of anyone if they are focused primarily on their basic needs. Longer term implications are also uncertain, but we believe if we take the opportunity to strategize today about the future that we want for our workplaces and build a plan that is based on those stakeholders that we mentioned in our hypothesis, we will be building a better workplace future for us all.
That's the goal. How do we get there? So what are some immediate next steps that we can all start taking? Big change, it's not easy. But if we build upon the lessons we're learning in this enormous global workplace and social experiment, Amy and I believe that positive change can come out of it. And so it starts with those lessons that we learned in Choice Theory 101, asking, listening, acting, and empowering people to have more control over their work lives. There are many forms that asking and listening can take: company-wide surveys, focus groups, interviews, and it's important to note that organizations should be prepared to act upon the information that they've heard from employees. Amy and I are currently engaging several large companies in this process. My team is currently developing a series of cross-sectional interactive focus groups for a global company to query workers about how their perspectives pertaining to office work, tools, workspace, and culture may have changed as a result of working remotely. Amy, you have an incredible survey you're analyzing right now, right? Can you share a little bit about that, your initial findings with us, Keith?
Yeah, happy to. So my team is currently working with an organization who asked us to help them develop an employee-centric approach to their reintegration back into the office. They've asked and listened, and now we're working through what the ACT part looks like. The first phase of this outreach was a survey to about 3,000 people. And if this is any indicator of how strongly employees want to be heard, we had a 78% response rate to our survey, which is pretty much unheard of. And they also only had 3 days to respond. So we were just very pleased with that response.
That's incredible. That never happens in a survey.
No, it never happens. Never happens. So 96% of respondents stated that they were able to effectively accomplish their individual work at home, while, like you all and all of us, they primarily miss spontaneous conversations, in-person meetings, and social interactions, all elements that the office offer. It begs the question, what is the next normal workplace going to support if most of us can accomplish our individual work at home? So we will leave you with this idea that work is not a place we go, it is what we do. Thank you so much for all of your time today, and we'd like to open it up to some questions from you guys through Diana.
Thanks, you guys, that was great. The meeting SIFT was really fun to see. Everyone's responses. And I would just encourage anyone who has questions that they want us to think about to put that into the chat. But in the meantime, I have some questions for you guys. So with remote work, and a lot of people are talking about this right now, how can offices still bring everyone together and create a sense of culture?
So I think as we're all probably experiencing right now, and learning through various new software, online meeting tools, there's a number of ways that we're starting to connect virtually. But as you saw and we discussed, people are still yearning for that sense of you know, just being in person with one another. So I think Amy and I would both argue that coming out of this, the office is still going to be play an important role of creating culture. And then virtual interactions can supplement that. But physically being together and feeling that energy, I think I saw the word energy brought up earlier, is so much a part of the culture. But also, as we talked about, the policy and the leadership will set the stage as well for that culture.
Great. Okay. So do either of you see this as the end to the open office concept? We've heard a lot about that in the last few years, but what is this going to do to it?
Yes. That's not a yes answer. I was agreeing that we've heard a lot about this in the past years. Colleen and I have discussed this as well, and we don't think it's such a far swing of the pendulum, right? That the truth is going to lie somewhere in between, and I think that it might shift the way that we think about open office. I mean, once we get past this first horizon line, also. But if we do prove over time that we can all work effectively from home, I think that, you know, people are going to need a place to come to work, whether it's because of preference or their effectiveness. They need some place to come complete their individual work if it's not at home. So we don't think it's going away. We think that maybe, you know, the ratios of spaces might change, because why provide all of that space for individual work when a large percentage of it is being done now and shifting to the home office or some other remote location? But no, we don't think anything's really going away. It's there's going to be a shift. And I think we have this opportunity to really rethink those ratios and what people need to have access to in the office, because you still need a place to touch down and do your work in between meetings and things like that as well, if you are primarily coming into the office for that interaction.
And I think just to, you know, further on that point, I think there is going to be a shift in thinking about being more deliberate about designing those spaces. You know, there was an indication that this was already happening before the pandemic. It's called activity-based work. So creating spaces that are very intentional for specific types of work and interaction. And I think that's where we're going to see people leaning towards, and work from home or working remotely will be considered a space type.
So I guess kind of as a follow-up to that, thinking about the other significant piece of office space, how do you think that the next normal will look at gathering spaces?
I'm so excited for that potential right there alone. I think, you know, again, we saw that people want to come together for many reasons, right? It could be for mentorship. There's definitely a certain amount of mentorship that you can't replicate digitally, right? Versus face-to-face time. There's those cultural moments. There are those just, you know, being a designer, I can't necessarily present tactile things as effectively in a digital realm. So I think gathering spaces are going to be one of those space types that we have more awareness about now, and we're much more deliberate and intentional, and we might be less likely. I been practicing in workplace for a while now. For so long, those places were like, oh, that's just, you know, the cafe, nobody's going to go there, nobody's going to work there. And we started to see that shift, and co-working kind of brought that to the fore before the pandemic. You know, co-working had a lot of cultural gathering type spaces in addition to other activity-based work type spaces. So I think people are just going to want more options for variation on what those spaces look like and where they are, you know. Do they have to be in the city? Could you have multiple gathering spaces in different locations geographically?
Yeah, makes sense.
That you may or may not own as an organization.
Wow, maybe you have a membership.
Yeah. And I just want to add one comment to that as well, as we think about people who are, you know, when we talk about team building and onboarding, because although I think, you know, we've learned that teams are seem to be doing okay with some of the survey work that we've done, and they feel as connected as they did before the pandemic. So they went into this 100% virtual world and they still feel connected to their teams, which is good, although they still miss seeing them in person. I think about when you're onboarding new team members, and this is near and dear to me because I just joined a new team very recently, and I know some of them from my past life, but I haven't had the pleasure of really getting to know all of them. So I think that, you know, the office is still going to be a really important place for people to continue to get to know each other as well.
Right. So we have a question in the chat. Do you think remote work will change how employees are being, and then I think a word might have been left out right now, but the second part of the question, with payment being linked to how many hours you clock in, will remote work create a shift towards task-based or salary reimbursement?
That's a great question. Oh. I'm not certain I have a decisive answer on that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting because the gig economy, again, was something that was leaning towards that direction already, right? Like you get paid on how many rides you give or, you know. So I think there's a potential, but I do think we're not going to see a shift completely in that direction because that would be really unstable, as we're also seeing, right? Like a lot of those gig economy workers who are still working right now have been striking because of their lack of security and high risk, right? So while that might be a possibility, again, I don't think, like the open office, I don't think we're going to see the pendulum completely swing in the other way, but I could be wrong. I'm not an economist.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So let's see, another question. What ways can companies think about supporting worker choice in an equitable way?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead, Amy.
Yeah, well, you know, I think, and when we talk about equity, right, we're talking about, you know, I think what we see often these days is if an organization doesn't already have a flexible work policy, it often what we see is that it varies by manager. Like some managers are like, well, we don't have a policy, but I completely support my people, you know, working from home, whatever works best for them. And then you have on the other end of the spectrum, you know, you have managers that really want to see people in the office as well. So I think that, you know, I think that it still should be in, you know, the if we think back to choice theory, it should be a conversation between a worker, an employee, and their supervisor, manager, whomever, to figure out what works best for them and their team, right? It's a team effort. And that goes back to that empathy and trust that I know you're going to do the best job for the organization while, you know, you can do the best job for you and whatever your circumstances are that make it better for you to work from home, right? So it's a give and take, I think. So I still think that organizations just need to support managers in helping them through that conversation, and not having that be just a top-down kind of mandate, if you will.
Right. So another question from the chat. Do you think remote work during this pandemic may help to further humanize some of the relationships that we have with colleagues and vendors, since we're getting a peek into their home through Zoom and Teams and all of those platforms?
Of course. Now you all know I'm potty training someone right now.
Yeah.
I love this. If you have to find the silver lining in a pandemic, I totally agree with that question that we're just seeing a raw side to everyone. And quite frankly, and I haven't really witnessed this all that much, but we know there's some folks out there that are putting up their fronts and, you know, and I'm guilty of it too. I curated my bookshelf in the back. Right. But I do think, you know, the yoga pants, we heard about yoga pants and wine anytime. I think it's great. I think there's going to be only good things that come out of that. So I'm excited. What about you, Amy?
Yeah, I mean, I think the humanity of it speaks to a certain level of vulnerability. I mean, I think we had, what, 160 people or so sign up for this. I've never had 160 people in my apartment. Like, welcome, everybody. But I do believe it's tremendously humanizing. I had the benefit a few weeks ago of attending a training session, and it was a group of global strategists. And so we were looking into each other's living rooms from Boston to San Francisco to Singapore to Geneva, Switzerland, to Paris and to London. And it was just such a humanizing experience to see everybody in their own environment. And just, you know, it's just a very vulnerable, I think, place to be. And I think it's, I think that leads to good cohesion and trust amongst teams. It's like you're seeing it, you know?
Okay, I think we have time for one more quick question so everyone can move on to their next Zoom call.
Happy sooner than I am.
What can one do to become an agent for change or to encourage their leadership to expand choice as part of their culture?
Oh, love that question. So I think step one would first be to look at the organization you are working for, to understand, wow, are they more choice-based or are they more external controlling? And then you might have to ask yourself some other questions depending on what the response is to that. So I think there's a lot of ways you could go about this, but I'm an advocate for just plowing ahead and forging that path on your own if you don't feel like you might have the support that you would need. So, you know, why not issue your own company-wide survey? We've got the tools now to do it. So easy, you know, MS Forms, SurveyMonkey, right? Like, send it all out. But also you could, you know, approach mid-level management or leadership positions if you feel like you have a good advocate there, right? And say, hey, I think this is really important, you know? And I think especially, I mean, we should all be asking leadership these questions. And I was telling Amy earlier, you know, even if you have a remote work policy or you see the need for change, like we all have to question this again coming out of the pandemic, because now we all, you know, we walked through the door. We can't go back. We have a different perspective. And so if we don't reevaluate coming out of this, then that's a problem.
That's a huge missed opportunity. Yes.
Yeah, that's great advice. Yeah. I think everyone should feel empowered after learning about what you've presented today. So thank you. Thank you all for joining us. And please do share your feedback at communications@architects.org. Please join me in thanking Colleen Aria, principal at Stantec, and Amy Hill, principal at Workflow, for joining us today. This is an important topic that many of us will be discussing for a while, including the BSA, and this is just the start of planning going forward. You can stay up to date on our latest news at architects.org through Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and Twitter, and of course, signing up for our weekly e-newsletter, Currents. If you are interested in supporting or in sponsoring a BSA program, please contact Billy Craig, B. Craig, at architects.org. Have a great day. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.